we gather for worship on this day, I hope that you are still kind of living in the glow of Valentine's Day, because we want to talk a lot about God's love this morning. And I don't know about you, but once the chocolate's all gone and the little funny little candies that people give you and so forth at Valentine's Day, the hearts are still on the wall, right? And the theme of love is still before us. And as I mentioned in the prayer in the bulletin this morning, it's one thing to know about the love of Cupid's arrow and chocolates and Valentine's card, but it's another thing to know the love of God, which is shown to us in His Son on the cross. Amen? So we'll talk of that this morning and how that love might be a part of our life. Our opening hymn sings of the gift of love. It sings of the gift of the Spirit to us in that love. So I call you to turn to the hymn that's number 336. Gorgeous words, singable tune. So let us rise and stand together as we join with our choir in our processional hymn number 336.
Singing love songs and and being together, showing love. The trustees and the finance meetings are asked to meet near the stage right after today's service for a brief meeting, and our church council meeting is this coming Wednesday. As you know, you all are invited to the church council meetings. We will be gathering in the chapel at 6:15 so that we can ask God's blessings on our meeting and on our church. Also, Michelle has asked me to announce that the Easter flower order forms are on the welcome table in the Northex area. The orders are due March the 2nd, so you need to be taking care of those in the next couple of weeks. So if you're interested, please pick up one of those forms and place them either in the offering plate or give them to the church office, and we will be able to do that. Being no further announcements, we are glad that you are here. The peace of Christ be with you. May we share that peace with one another.
Thank you.
join me in the call to worship? All praise to you, O Lord. You give us the command to love, and you send us Jesus to show us how.
It is our joy to hear your word, and our desire to live by it always.
As we do the Chanticle of Love, I'm going to ask you to keep two different places open in your hymnal. The first one is 108. So if everybody can find 108.
408.
I'm sorry, 408. And 408 is going to be our response. And then, after we sing the response, we're going to keep our hand in 408, and we're going to flip to 646, which is the Canticle of Love. And we're going to read through that, and every time we see an R for the refrain, we're going to flip back to 408 to sing that refrain, as opposed to the one that's there. I've asked Ann to play through the refrain once, and then we'll sing the refrain, and then we will go on to the words that are on 646. Okay, Ann?
Oh,
find mercy and grow old together.
Love rejoices in the right, bears, believes, hopes, and endures all things. For love is faithful and endless.
See you again, and I think we should have lit the candles this morning.
Samaritan, right? You know that story, man lying by the side of the road. Three people pass by, one fellow from another country, he stops and helps him out. And that's good. And we were wondering what good headline that might be in the newspaper. Thank you. that in some ways there's more memory work in being a Boy Scout than there is in being a Christian. Remember this, we're never closer to God than when we pray. Amen. As a matter of fact, this piece I was reading lately said the best way to know God is in prayer. So let us join our hearts in prayer today, after first making various prayer requests, that we may know God in that way. You know, and it makes sense if you think about it. You may think and you know a person, but until you talk with that person, you don't really know them. So our talking with God is our way of getting to know them. And wait a minute, before we do this, I got to check. We have someone among us who I hadn't seen before. Could you introduce yourself?
My name is Keith Ricker, and I'm a member of Presbyterian Methodist Church.
And we're really happy to have you here today. Sorry if I embarrass you, but I just thought it was important that we all know each other in some way before you started here. Thank you. Well, what are our prayers for this day? We want to thank God, and we want to ask God for God's help in all things. And so, Christine?
Right, so kind of a praise, I guess, because I was able to witness to somebody, and I don't know where it's going to go or if it goes any further. But so, I always post something on Facebook about, Jesus or whatever. And yeah. I don't remember that little thing, but I think it was something like, we don't have to be perfect because we're Christians, and we're not trying to be perfect because we're Christians, we're trying to be Christians to ourselves, I forget what I said. But anyway, this one friend of mine said, she doesn't know what to believe, whether or not she believes in Jesus or not. And her grandmother said, her grandmother has told her that I can't do any wrong because I'm a Christian or something. And I don't remember exactly what I said, but I said that how I believe in is that that Jesus modeled for us, our life, and God forgives all the sins that we have done, and we don't have to be perfect, but we do the best we can or something. And long story short, whatever it is, and I said, I'm not going to force. I don't tell other people what to believe. I just tell people what I believe.
Yeah.
And long story short, I told her what I believe in, and she did thank me. So we can pray that if it is in God's will for her to believe.
Take that to heart. Yeah. We planted the seed.
Right? Yes.
And we pray God to nourish that seed and make her faith.
Amen. My sisters are back.
Oh yeah.
I'm sitting in the post-surgery section this morning.
Yeah. Like wounded warriors, you have returned. In fact, you had Martha and Carolyn here. That hand doing better. Good. And you're recovering as well. Amen. All right. We give thanks to God. Keeping in prayer the family of Ralph Adams, who died this past week after a long struggle with cancer. And we pray God's peace and strength to be with family and friends of his, and for God to receive Ralph's spirit into his keeping.
Comment. The beginning of the Scouts boat says, "On my honor, I will do my duty to God and my country."
On my honor, I will do my duty to God and my country. Amen. Let's remember what our duty is to God and the kingdom of God. Amen. Amen. Others? We keep in prayer Tom Edmonds, as I sent a message out that he expected. Tom has, as a result of an injury, an inability to close his left eye. It just will not close. And there was a surgery he was supposed to go through on Friday to remedy that, a specialist that was going to do some surgical work. For some reason, that was called off. And it's a huge disappointment because Tom just very much needs to get that eye closed. And it's postponed for, he thinks, another 3 weeks. So please keep Tom in our prayers, that the Lord be with him during that time. And he also has that palsy what's it called, that affects your face? Yeah, Bell's palsy. Prayers for that as well. Others? Pray for all those people that are in the way of that, somebody say the name of the virus.
Corona.
Yeah, coronavirus. So many people affected this, that the Lord give healing and strength.
Prayers for my mother who is suffering and recovering from shingles. It has zapped her strength terribly. She's having a hard time.
Yeah. What an affliction. What's your first name?
Joanne.
We pray for Phyllis's mom, Joanne, struggling with shingles. And I'm going to ask us in our prayers each week to keep the city of Baltimore, the area of Baltimore, in our prayers. There's so much violence, so much killing. We had a special service of prayer for the whole district clergy that came together. Because many of the clergy of our district are those that perform the funeral services for those who are killed. And just as importantly, try to bind up the wounds of the trauma that that killing brings. And the wounds of trauma in the police officers, the EMT, all those people that are, it's like the whole city is traumatized by this. So I would ask that each week, we just remember in our prayers, the city, the metropolitan area of Baltimore, afflicted by so much violence and harm. Let us pray. Wonderful God, you whose presence with us is unrelenting, you who are here nevertheless, and in all ways are by our side, in our midst, seen and unseen, felt and unfelt, always there, and always there, Lord, seeking to bring life out of destruction, beauty out of ugliness, friendliness out of alienation, and help and care out of dangerous situations. We thank you, Lord, because of the energy that you bring to us that just constantly wants to lift from the earth new life, new hope, and new joy. And we thank you, Lord, that you are there, because without you, we would be hopeless, we would be loveless, we would be without a power to care. And we lean and trust in you every day. We give you thanks, Lord, because your healing power is so wonderful. And we thank you, Lord, for those of us who are here today who have experienced that power in their lives and come and praise you for that goodness which you have shown us. Lord, we give you our thanks and praise. And we lift to you our hopes of recovery for those suffering through various kinds of ailments. For those who struggle with cancer, Lord, may you be strong in their very midst. And we keep Joanne in our prayers that you might be with her and make her strong and give her your comfort. That you might be with those who suffer loss. You might be with Ralph's family and friends and give them your strength and comfort. You might be with those who have suffered loss in recent shootings in Baltimore, that you might be surrounding them with your love. Burn the sweet incense of the spirit of your love in those places, in those hearts, and help recovery to happen. Help people to know that you are there to enable life to go on, the love to overcome hatred, and peace to overcome violence. Lord, may you be with this world as we struggle with a virus that seems to haunt us all, and that you may show the way to cure, the way to prevention, and the way to health. And that the destruction of that violence might soon cease. We look to you, Lord, because we know that there's another violence that haunts our world, and is the violence of sin. It is the violence of war. It is the violence of hunger and of homelessness. And we pray that you may cure that virus as well through the great antidote of your love shown to us in Jesus. And in his name we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Would you pray with me, please? Our Heavenly Father, thank you for being with us today as we hear these scriptures from Romans and the book and the Gospel of John from your word. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the miracles of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peacefully with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will reap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. I would like to share the Holy Gospel now, which comes from the Gospel of John. Chapter 14, verses 1 to 15. Would you stand if you are able? Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. And if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Would you join me in singing His Eye is on the Sparrow in the Faith We Sing book, number 2146.
And I would ask that we would sing just the first two verses, just verses 1 and 2. His eye is on the sparrow.
Thank you.
into my own personal life, I'm sorry. But it seemed to fit the service this morning, too. I grew up my high school years down in Anne Arundel County, a place called Lake Shore. And I went to this church called Magathie Methodist Church, and it was always thought it was good to have a church named after a river, right? And in the mornings, in the summer mornings, we had we had made this chapel down in the woods behind the church, and we had made benches out of cinder blocks and boards, and the women of the church made what they called sit-upons, things back with a newspaper that made a soft seat for you, and a dry seat on some dewy mornings, and we would worship down there, and us guys, and some of the girls too, made the choir. And every once in a while, they would ask somebody to sing a solo. And before they figured out that it's better for me to speak than sing, they asked me, would I sing this song? And I had heard Tennessee Ernie Ford, right, sing this on, and I thought this was the greatest possibility at all. And so I got my little songbook and learned the song and stood up to sing it. And I was so nervous, my voice quavered so much, it sounded like a little bird flying away. But I got through it, and for me it's a memory. So pardon the personal interruption, but maybe a little more personal interruption. You know, when you think about God, I hate to say this, but sometimes our thoughts think of God as a grumpy old man. Amen? Come on, own up to it. We do, because we talk about God as our Father. And for a fair number of us, our fathers, at least on some days, are kind of grumpy old men. What's this business with always having to wipe your feet and wash your hands? And he was the enforcer of that. Well, at least some fathers were. But I think that God's nature is a whole lot more filled with joy than that. I think that God, even in spite of the way things go in the world that God created, God laughs a whole lot more. So the other night, I had to go pick up my daughter from school. She goes to Stevenson University. Stevenson is on a hillside. And after a certain hour at night, you cannot drive your car onto the campus. They just don't go for that. And I got there after that hour, so I had to sit at the edge of the campus and wait for her to come down to me and come home for the weekend. And where I had my car waiting was at the base of a hill. And it's a hill that the students would have to walk to get down to a dormitory, which is over here, and a post office and so forth. So it was fairly well traveled. And in order to accommodate that, they had a set of three flights of stairs, ba-boom, 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 to go from up here to down here, where I was. And at night, there's not a whole lot of people walking that way, but as I'm sitting there waiting, I notice that there is a rail for these students to hang on to that goes down each flight, a nice steel rail. So here come a bunch of students. Loud and raucous they were, typical of college students, I'd say. But having a good time, and they get to the stairs, and they kind of stop for a moment. It's interesting to watch them. And one of the guys had his hat on backwards, of course, decided he wasn't going to walk down. You know what he did? He slid down. He slid down the first one, and kind of looked around and said, hey, that's cool. And he slid down the second one, a big smile, and he got down to the bottom of the third one, and he was laughing out loud. Not like he was showing off. He was just enjoying it, just having a good time. And he looked around at his friends who were with him as if to say, who's next? One boy almost got his butt up on the rail, and then he decided, no, I'm not going to do that. It was too dangerous. But this fellow went up, and he did it again, just for the pure joy of it. And I'm sitting there thinking, that's like God loving us. God enjoys loving us. God must, or he wouldn't keep doing it, right? Because you don't keep doing things that aren't a lot of fun. God loves us and enjoys loving us. As a matter of fact, that is what God is all about. God, in all that God does, is enjoying loving us. When God created the world, God was loving us. For God so loved the world, he created it. You know when it says the Spirit, the whole, and when I got this picture in mind, the whole scripture turned around for me. You know when it says in Genesis 1:1 that the Spirit of God brooded over the face of the deep, right? And it's like you're trying to figure out what I'm going to do with this message. It's the Spirit of love. And God in love says, I am going to make, I'm putting words in God's mouth. That's a daring thing to do, right? So if lightning comes down, I'm sorry. But I think God said, I am going to make a very lovely thing. And I'm going to call it Earth. I'll refer to it as the world. And in love, I'm going to turn that chaotic mess into something of form. With light and dark, earth and ocean, and plants, and birds and animals, and fish, and human beings. And it will be wonderful. And it'll be the greatest thing, because God will just love that earth that God has created. And God will love everything that's on it. And God will hope that everything that's on it will love each other. Because God knows that there's nothing more enjoyable than loving one another. I think that's why they invented Valentine's Day. So at least one day of the year we'll enjoy loving each other. So God does that and puts it down there and thought, well, and the greatest thing would be is if those whom I love would return love in return. But I don't care. I'm going to love them anyway. And the evidence of that is all through Scripture. We keep figuring out ways to not love each other. We keep creating new forms of being mean and hostile to one another, of dropping out of friendship, of entering into, I mean, right from the very beginning, God says to Adam and Eve, guess what? I created all this for you, and you're going to have a great time with it. As a matter of fact, I'm trusting you and kind of putting you in charge to take care of everything. Make sure everything works out really well. Oh, but there's one thing. You can't eat that tree there. I'm saving it. That's special. So what's the first thing they do? In greed, and because I want what I want when I want it, that's the basic nature of a lot of sin, isn't it? I want what I want when I want it. Amen. They blame it on the snake, but they grab it and eat of the tree. And from there on, it just keeps getting worse. But God never stops loving. You know, it's what the Noah story is. God loves us. Float above it all and rise to start afresh and anew because God is in the midst. And God knows that what that means is when because of the evil that has crept into the world, God has to suffer along with us because of the suffering that that has caused. So God is present with us all the time, loving us even in the midst of our suffering, even in the midst of our problems and questions. God, why did that happen? God, why did that happen? God, why did you let that happen? And God absorbs that blame. You know, he was, God, don't you do, God, why did you? And God absorbs all that blame and takes it to himself and says, I'm still present with you. I'm still there. I know you're asking a lot of questions, and I'm here to love you. I don't know if I can give you the answers that you need, but I'm here to love you right in the midst of that. And I'm here to help you keep breathing in the midst of all that. I'm here to help you keep living and loving and finding your way through. I'm here for you in that because God can't do anything but love us. That's God's nature. And God would hope that it would catch on. But God has an immense problem. Because how does God get his love injected into a world that's such a mess as ours? How does God do that? How does God enter into a world with the huge amount of armaments that we have and the expanding list of people who are homeless, hungry, and ill? How does God enter into that? How does God enter into a world where all we seem to know how to do is to fight with each other and set up sides so that the Republicans don't like the Democrats, and some of the Democrats don't even like each other, so that we can define ourselves as those people who say we're good and you're not? How does God enter into the world? What God does. You know what God does. I don't have to tell you. What does he do? He sends a living representative of himself, right? And he decides that there's going to be this one who is God's son, because he is such a perfect representation of himself, to send into the world to be himself in the world. When Philip, in the scripture that's read, says to Jesus, "Jesus, can you show us God?" I don't know what Philip thought. Did Philip think that maybe Jesus could bring down this big glowing orb that Philip could see? I don't know. But you know what Jesus says is, if you've seen me, you've seen God. Because everything I say is God's word. Everything I do is God's act. I don't do anything unless the Father tells me to do it. I am, Jesus said, the perfect representative of God. And God sends Jesus to inject his love into the nature of the world. And Jesus does this by seeking to inject that love into every person he meets. I think Jesus laughed a lot too. Don't you think so? Don't you think that there was probably nothing better and happier that he could do than healing somebody? I mean, wouldn't you feel that way? This work in my school. Can you hear me? There it is. It's my heart. So if you go out and you know that day you can make a leper clean, oh man, that's great. If you're going to go out and you know you're going to set free evil spirit that's in somebody and give them the restoration of life, that's got to delight you. And in that joy, Jesus just can't help but keep doing all these things. What are we going to do today, Jesus? I don't know. Let's go out and see who we can heal. Let's go out and see who we can raise from the dead. And then Jesus turns to them and says, the same love that's in me, God wants to put in you. For some of you, he says, it's going to be a pretty tight squeeze. Because you got so much in you that isn't love, that God's got to push and shove and wedge in there the beginnings of his love so that you can love and not do all that other stuff that you do that's just a waste of time and a big trouble and causes a lot of pain. Don't do that. But God just wants. And Jesus said, the way that you get to know God, he said, is to start loving your neighbor. Because when you love your neighbor, you just open a little wedge through which God can shove some more love in, and more love in. And you then not only love your neighbor, but you love your neighbor's friends. Huh? Then you not only love your neighbor's friends, but you love the relatives. And you even wind up loving your own relatives. Miracle. Miracles. All of them. Even that strange uncle. Right? And then Jesus says, here's what God wants to do. He wants to come and live in you, so that you will be like him and like God. That is, having nothing better to delight your life than to love. Nothing else that you would do or even think of doing would be better than loving. And Jesus said, you will do the same things I do. Did you hear it? It's the most amazing thing in Scripture. Jesus says, you will do the same acts that I do. You know, you'll be able to go out and talk to some strange Samaritan woman. I don't want to get into the subject of talking to strange women, but it's not a bad but it's a good thing. I won't tell that, it takes too long. So, you will be able to, oh, I don't know, cleanse lepers, heal the sick, feed 5,000, or maybe at least 100. All we have to do is feed this 100 is do it 50 times, right? And we'll be feeding 5,000. Not a bad deal. Oh, and by the way, you'll also be able to find a Zacchaeus in a tree somewhere and make life better for him because of God's love. And raise the dead. And you might even be resurrected yourself with God's love in you. But wait, there is a word on this. It does not happen automatically. You have to work at it to have Christ's love in you. Amen? It does not happen automatically. I mean, it would be wonderful, it would, if just you go out of here right now and instead of your first reaction to something that was offensive to you, to be mean about that, to be loving about that, but it takes work. One other reason I had a fairly tricky call to worship this morning, and thanks for going along with it, is that I just want to exemplify that it takes some work to be Christ-like. As a matter of fact, there is a man whose name is McKnight, who has written a book called Christoformity. You get it? Christoformity. He said the job of every church, and I assume that would be our job here at Trinity, would be to make a community whose culture specializes in Christoformation. That is, that everything we would do, everything that we are, everything that we specialize in, would be having the purpose of forming Christ in us, or forming us into Christ. Amen? I mean, we are here to make sandwiches, that's for sure. And we are here to make a good community together. But more than anything else, we are here to help each other become like Christ. Okay? So that we would be a part of God's tremendous project of making this world into the realm of the God of love. So that the whole world finds more delight in loving one another than they do in having a good sock portfolio. Could you imagine? Do you get tired as I do that after every newscast they got to tell me how the stocks are doing? I think that's nice, but what I really want to know is what's the price of gas? That's what I want. what I really want to know is has anybody in this economy done anything to get some of the people who are living on the street off the street and in some kind of good place to live? Has anybody done anything to do something to improve the condition of the schools in our cities? Has anybody done anything? I mean, you don't get a daily report in that. My heart would rejoice if the daily reports showed more love. So, I'm off the subject. So I think that what would be really good is if all we do forms a culture here at Trinity, as a lot of things we do already, forms a culture that would help each of us become like Christ, to become Christ. And our asking for each other would be not just, how are you, but is Christ in you today? Where have you seen Christ in you today? Well, it comes with some effort and work. McKnight, in the book I mentioned, says it comes with some diligent study so that Christ becomes not just a name, but becomes a reality, a living reality. And the preciousness of his love lives in our hearts. I'm going to call us to study together. Just three times, I beg you to come out on three Monday nights together, the first three Monday nights of Lent, and let us study together. The preciousness of love is a little book I found. Not because You need this intellectual stimulation, but because we need to get together as a body, 25, 30, 40 of us, to study together and to help each other know better who is Christ. How can I have Christ more deeply into my heart? And then it comes by strenuous prayer. Christ sets the example when in the garden he prayed so hard he sweat blood. That's prayer. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart, the old spiritual says. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart. I'm not sure that maybe that hymn should be our prayer every day through Lent. Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart. And then we will be, as that project succeeds, we will be the happiest place on earth, right? Because if God rejoices in loving, we will too. And we will have more jokes in our sermons, more beat in our hymns, and particularly more living and loving in our life together. I hope that through Lent, which begins in 2 Wednesdays, we will work hard, diligently, I would say, at the project of being a culture, being a community whose culture is Christoformity. Make me like Christ. Let's pray. Good and gracious God, we want to be a part of it. We want you to be in us. We want to do our part to fulfill your purpose in our little corner of the world. And we want to see your kingdom, your realm of love, present with us and through us, our neighbors and their friends and their families, until it reaches all and we all share in the joy of loving one another.
Join me in the affirmation of faith, which is number 885. It is a modern affirmation that we offer to the Lord today. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. Please be seated. I hope you had an opportunity to complete the tear-off portion of the bulletin so that you might include it as we offer in our gifts and tithes.
because this is a third Sunday, we do offer the opportunity to share in communion following our service. It is prepared for us. Those who would wish to join me would meet at the front of the church. In your bulletin today was a page about stewardship. Next Sunday, we'll be speaking more of our stewardship as we lead up to our commitment Sunday on the first Sunday of March. Take that and read it. It has some interesting stories in it, some powerful scripture, and some appeals to our commitment to the church. I appeal to you to be with us this evening, starting at 4:30. We got a lot of work to do. And as Grandma says, many hands make light work, right? So come and light up the work. Oh, there may even be a sandwich for you if we work things correctly as we share our love with each other. Now may the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make God's light to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord work in our hearts to form us in Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.